The subject that we have chosen to discuss tonight is very complicated. Even then, I believe it is very important, because many people practice their religions without clear understanding, just applying only belief or developing their faith. Now, our subject is, what is the Buddhist attitude? Or if not, what did the Buddha say about belief and faith? Usually when people talk about religion, they say, our faith is Christianity, or our faith is Buddhism, or our faith is Hinduism. The word faith they use for religion. But as Buddhists, it is not appropriate for us to use that our faith is Buddhism. It is not a faith. It is not a belief. It is not a theory. It is not a philosophy. It is not a psychology. It is not a traditional practice. Then what is it? It is dharma. Dharma is free from all these words that I mentioned. What is faith? What is belief? We believe certain things by using our very limited thinking power and limited senses. Our human thinking power and senses are very limited. It is not so easy for us to penetrate, to analyze, to understand things properly. We take things as they appear, but not as they are. There is vast difference. So when we develop our faith or belief, later when our knowledge, our understanding, our education, our thinking power, our experience and maturity, when these things were advanced, at that time we will come to know the faith, the belief we had earlier are wrong. A small children have faith and belief in certain things. But when they grow up, after their education, they will come to know that the belief and faith they had earlier are wrong, not correct. So these things are going on changing and changing according to the time, circumstances, our knowledge, our understanding and experience. Therefore, the Buddha did not advise for anybody to apply faith or belief at once. Then what is the advice that he gave? He says, whenever there is something you get some information, some news. At once you should not accept that as truth. Without investigating, without thinking, without using your sense of reason. At the same time, you should not reject saying that I don't believe. This is the advice. This is very important. Without rejecting, without accepting, keep your eye on, observe, investigate, think. Later, you will come to know whether it is right or wrong. Then you can decide whether to accept or to reject. So don't come to any hasty conclusion at once, either to reject or to say. I remember Krishnamurti, one of the best thinker who had no particular religion, but everybody respected him as a great thinker. He says, those who come and shout, I believe in God, again another group come and shout, I don't believe in God. He said, both are in the same boat. They are shouting, just using their emotion, not through understanding. Those who say they believe in God do not know anything about God. Those who say they do not believe in God also do not know anything about God. But those who are free from both are the people who can understand who the God is. This is a very good advice for people not to accept anything emotionally without thinking and using their sense of reason. There is very important word in the Buddha's teaching that is called saddha. People interpret this as faith. Actually, the real meaning is not faith but confidence. There is difference between faith and confidence. Faith we accept or we establish, we apply at the beginning without reasoning. Later, when realizations appear in our mind, that faith becomes confidence. Faith is changeable. Confidence is not changeable. Because we gain confidence through understanding and experience, not mere imaginations or creating some sort of narrow concept. In the Buddha's teaching, Alavaka Sutta, Alavaka asks this question. Kingsudha Vittam Purisasa Settam. What is the highest wealth for a man? The Buddha says, saddheda vittan purisassa settan. Saddha, confident, is the highest wealth for the mankind. There is no another wealth which is superior to their confidence. What is this confidence? Whatever we do, we must have confidence. Whenever you are going to do some business, you must have confidence. Otherwise, you won't get inspiration, courage for you to carry on. There will be a lot of disturbances, frustrations, disappointment, unhappiness. But when we develop confidence, your mind is strong enough to face any challenges. Therefore, confidence is important. Whenever you want to lead a married life, you must have strong confidence between husband and wife. This confidence becomes a very strong force to overcome so many problems and worries and shortcomings and anger and jealousy and grudge and ill will. They can overcome all the disturbances if they establish confidence at the beginning. They can share pleasant and unpleasant occurrences equally without accusing or blaming the other. When you come to religion, there must be confidence. If you perform your religious activities without confidence, it is not so easy for you to gain the good effect or the result. If you perform your religious activities as your duties, as your responsibilities, as your tradition, as your custom, or your culture, or your way of life, if confidence is not there, you cannot get the real effect. Therefore, especially in the religious field, confidence is the most important thing you have to cultivate whenever you are going to perform any kind of religious services, whether chanting or listening to a talk, or whether conducting a blessing service or puja or dana, any kind of meritorious deeds, you must have confidence. Without this confidence, you won't get the good result. Especially in Abhidhamma, there are three conditions for you to consider very carefully whenever you are going to perform some sort of religious service. Jnana Sampayutta, you must have knowledge, understanding, significance, why you are going to do this. Without this understanding, if you do this as your traditions or customs and duties, you cannot experience the real good result. That is why knowledge is important. On the other hand, This idea must be implanted, created in your own mind. Take for instance, now you wanted to come and listen to this Dhamma talk. That is your idea. You have created this idea in your mind, you want to come and attend. Then another person come and attend this talk. Somebody ask him to come. Inform him. He get the idea from another person. Therefore, idea is not his own. He is not the one who created the idea that he want to go and listen to this Dhamma. When you want to go and give dana, the idea you have to create in your mind, your own idea. If not, another person come and tell you, we are going to prepare a dana, do you like to join with us? Yes, certainly. But you also contribute something. But idea is not yours. The effect of the merit differ. If the idea is yours, you experience the full result. Again, the purity of the mind. At that time, when you perform this religious service, your mind must be free from selfishness, from anger, from jealousy, from illusion. If you perform your religious service by keeping all these evil thoughts in your mind, you cannot experience the good result. These are the three conditions. The time that you perform this religious service, your mind must be free from evil thought. Later they may come and occupy the mind, but at that time you must have free mind. Then you must know why it is necessary, what is the significance of this kind of meritorious deeds. Not as your traditions or customs, or not just to please others, but by knowing why it is important. The other one is, you had to create the idea in your own mind that I want to do this. So here, Shraddha, confidence, important not as a belief, not as a faith, but through understanding. So the Buddha says, confidence is the highest wealth. In our day-to-day life, whatever we do, we must do that with confidence. Then we will succeed. That is the idea. Another occasion, the Buddha went to a Brahmin, Kasi Bharadwaja, when he was working in the paddy field. He went with his begging bowl, standing there. That man is very stingy man. He does not like to give anything to anybody. Whenever the Buddha come to know, they are like this, purposely he goes there to train these people. So he was holding his begging bowl. Then this old man started to scold the Buddha. We are working here under hot sun, and you just come with your begging bowl and standing there without doing anything. Why can't you also come and do some work? He challenged. Then the Buddha said, my dear friend, do you know I am also working? How can you say you are working? We cannot see anything with you, just only holding your begging bowl. Then he said, you do not know how I do paddy field work, planting. He said, Saddha bijang tapo utti panya me yuga nangalam hiri isa mano yuttam sati me pala pajanam. Then he went on explaining what are the things that he used for this cultivation. Saddha bija, saddha, confidence, bija, biji, seed. I use my confidence as seed to plant. There he used this word confidence by considering a very deep meaning. Why he used the word bija, seed? When we plant a seed, a mango, or durian, or rambutan, the root goes down, the plant come up. Later, when this tree become a very big tree, the roots hold, support, otherwise the wind can topple this tree. If the roots are not strong enough, the tree cannot stand. In the same manner, whatever we do without confidence, whether our business or whether our household life, or our religious activities can collapse at any time. Disturbances, misunderstanding, anger can attack, disturb. If the roots are strong, the tree never falls down. The wind cannot attack. If the confidence is strong in our mind, for us to perform our religious activities, no disturbances whatsoever in this world can change our mind, can stop our good work, can interrupt our religious activities. Therefore, confidence is the most important thing for us to do anything in this world. What is this confidence on the other hand? By realizing that it is good, it is useful, it is meaningful, we create very strong determination. We establish this determination in our mind. Under any circumstances, we never give up. There is a saying in Indian philosophy, Ajaramaravat Prajno Vidyamartanta Chintayet, in Sanskrit language. Vidya and Artha. A study and earning, business. When you come to study, the philosophy says, you never die, you are immortal. That means not to think that this is enough, not necessary to study anymore. There is no end, there is no limit. You have to determine to study more and more and more. Don't think that you are going to die very soon. Again, when you come to business, think you are not going to die. Then you get the idea. Use your full effort. Otherwise, you think, why should I work so hard? After a few years' time, I may die. What is the big idea of working so hard? But not to create such idea. Of course, this is not Buddhism. This is Indian philosophy, but very good idea for householders, for lay people, to continue their work, their business, and their education with confidence. Again, Aslam, similar advice. When you are going to do business, you must think that you never die. You go ahead with your business with confidence, with faith. But when the time comes for you to pray, think, today or tomorrow you may die. Therefore, you should not neglect your prayer, your religion. Deep meaning. In every religion, there are some good teachings for others to learn. What is the Buddha's advice? In Dhammapada, he says, when you come to perform some religious services, meritorious deeds to lead a religious life, you should not neglect like this. When a person's hairs are burning, what sort of action that you take immediately to stop this one? In the same manner, without neglecting, you had to perform your religious meritorious deeds. Because life is uncertain. Similar teachings. So confidence is very, very important for us. That confidence strengthens the mind to face any problems, calamities, disturbances. That is the advantage of it. If you start your work without confidence, when little bit of disturbances come, you want to give up or you want to run away. Again, the Buddha has introduced that there are 7 kinds of wealth for all of us. Saddhadhana, Siladhana, Hiri Ottapyandhana, Sutadhananche, Chagoche, Panyame, Sattamandana. 7 kind of wealth. There is vast difference between rich man and wealthy man. Rich man is not a wealthy man. Rich man is not a happy man, but wealthy man is very happy. Wealthy man feel security. Rich man feel insecurity. Rich man get excitement. Wealthy man never get excitement. What is the difference? Here the Buddha says, 7. If you have these 7 kinds of wealth, you are very wealthy and you can do anything whatever you want. What rich men cannot do. Rich men cannot sleep peacefully without fear. Wealthy man can sleep anywhere. Some rich men cannot eat gastric ulcer because of worries, disturbances and fear, gastric ulcer. But wealthy man can eat very well, no problem. First, wealth is saddha, confidence. If you can cultivate your confidence in your housework, in your day-to-day affairs, in your married life, in your business, in your office, in your social work, in your religious field, you can do all these work peacefully, efficiently, without creating worries and disturbances because of that confidence. Second one is sila dhana, discipline. Sila means discipline. We must have certain discipline at home, in front of children, in front of ladies, in front of parents, in front of brothers and sisters. We have different type of discipline. Our ancient culture, way of life, depend on these principles. Discipline. When you go out, when you associate with others, we must have different kind of discipline. Not to interrupt, not to disturb, to behave as cultured human beings. When you come to associate with rulers in that country, different kind of disciplinary code for us to observe. When we are going to associate with religious people, teachers, elders, different kind of discipline. So we cannot apply the same disciplinary code to each and every person, different status. This is called sila. Another meaning of sila means training ourselves to be good. Now you observe sila, pancha sila, eight precepts, Attanga Sila. What is the meaning of Sila? Sila means training. I train myself to be good. That is the idea of observing Sila. It is not a law given by God or Buddha or anybody. By knowing these things are wrong, therefore I try to train myself not to commit, not to do these things. Not because of the punishment, just to escape from the punishment, but by knowing these things are wrong. The Buddha's way of teaching is like this. He says, I advise you not to do bad things. You can understand what those bad things are. But this is not a law, not a commandment. Not because I am going to punish you if you violate. I am telling you according to my own experience. Therefore, this is not a theory or a belief or philosophy. My own experience. Now, which is more reliable? Experience or theory or belief or commandment or law. I have done lot of bad deeds during many previous births. I can remember how I had to suffer because of those bad deeds. Even within this lifetime, I am suffering from 12 kinds of sicknesses, the Buddha says. Then he explained, I am suffering from this and this and that because I have done this and that during one of my previous births. So these bad karmic effects had no chance to affect me. And now they are attacking me. That is why I advise you not to do bad things. You also can understand easily, not alone. If you say, oh, I cannot do this because the Buddha says we should not do this. This is a small children's language. It is not that Buddha or God says we should not do that. What happened to your thinking power? You also have a mind to think and to understand. When you keep away by thinking, this is wrong. If I do this, I create enormous sufferings and worries and disturbances and pains. Therefore, I don't like to do that. This is a Buddhist way of thinking. Buddha's way of teaching. Again he says, I advise you to do good things. Do some service to others. Don't be selfish. Don't be stingy. Don't be jealous. Do some service to others to release their suffering. I have done a lot of good deeds. I can remember what sort of pleasant, peaceful, happy, prosperous, fortunate life I had the opportunity to experience such good result because of the good deeds, services that I have done. Therefore, I also advise you, make use of this valuable human life by doing some service to others. So simple. Not necessary to study philosophy or psychology to understand the Buddha's teaching. Again he says, I advise you not to kill, not to destroy the life of other living being. If you cannot understand why it is bad, then think in this way. Attanam upamam kattva nahaneya naghate. When another person come and try to kill you with a gun or knife, how do you feel? You feel very nice? You must understand. When you are going to kill another living being, that living beings also experience the same pain, fear, worries, disturbances, all the disturbances. This is more than enough for you to understand why it is bad. Is it necessary for you to get order from heaven not to kill? Why can't you understand that it is wrong? Therefore, you should not say, or the Buddha say, we should not kill, therefore we cannot kill. Yeah, small children. The Buddha remind you. Then you have to think. This is the way how to practice Buddhism. So sila means by considering in this way, not because of punishment. If I do this, God will punish me. If I do this, the Buddha will punish me. Therefore, I don't know what to do. If there is no such punishment, you can do any dirty, cruel, wicked, harmful things. Only for your own protection, you avoid evil things. But you have never developed, never cultivated your kindness, your compassion, your sympathy, your understanding, your unity and harmony, friendship, goodwill. No, that because of punishment, only punishment. So by considering all these good things, when you keep away from bad things, then you cultivate your way of life. Sila is there, discipline is there. So the Buddha regard this as highest wealth, because there is no guilty feeling in our mind if we can maintain that. Throughout our life, we can lead a peaceful life. In fact, we are not scared of death, because we know if there is another life after our death, that life cannot be a miserable one, because I have not committed these things. I uphold my principle, my seal, my discipline. This will become the highest wealth. All the properties that we have accumulated during our lifetime, we had to drop here. And this physical body, most precious, valuable thing to us, whole day and night, we are spending our life to look after this body. But this body creates enormous sufferings and pains and troubles and disturbances. After our death, we drop this one here. But the life goes away. But that life goes alone, without carrying any of our properties, but carry two things: all the good karmas and all the bad karmas. Carry. Now, which one is heavier? The mind balance. Which one is heavier, the bad karma or good karma? Then the rebirth take place according to that weighty karma. Whether become humans or animals or spirit or ghost or deva or brahma, decide by that mental faculty, not by God, not by another person. See, that is why the Buddha said this is the highest wealth. When the death comes one day, without crying, without worrying, without creating confusion, we can face peacefully, because we have confidence, wealth, discipline, sila, we observe. Saddha dhanam, sila dhanam. Sutta dhanam. Sutta means learning, listening, reading, thinking, to understand the truth. We can understand many things, but not the truth. It is very difficult to understand the truth. We create our own imagination, but it is not the truth. On the other hand, we don't like the truth, because truth is not in our favor sometimes. Then we don't like it. At that time we behave as self-hypocrite. We don't want to face fact. We have to train our mind to face fact, reality. We cannot hide. We cannot create imagination. You know, there is a huge bird in the desert. What is the name? I forgot. The huge, cannot fly but can run very fast in the desert. I forgot the name. Never you know the creature. So when people want to catch this bird, this bird run and run and run and run, now cannot run anymore. Then try to hide. What did it do? How to hide? Poke the beak under the sand, because the eyes are gone under the sand. Then this creature think that the man cannot see. He is hiding. So our self-hypocrisy is exactly like this. We try to hide as hypocrites. So the Buddha's advice is, cultivate your mind. Have some principles. I know, we cannot observe all the precepts or principles at once, or even within one lifetime. Now let us take the Buddha. Why it has taken such a long period for Buddha to gain his enlightenment? Because of the difficulty of reducing and reducing and reducing, reducing all the bad habit, bad thought, bad deeds. And to cultivate good deed, good thoughts, good act. Take long time, but don't worry. At least few good principles you can maintain, but you have to make up your mind. Under any circumstances, I am not going to violate this. And then it will become principle. You know so many previous birth stories of the Buddha. He has decided to sacrifice his whole life for the sake of his principle. He did not agree to violate the principle to protect this body. That is called principle. Saddhadanam siladhanam. Then hiri, ottappa, shame and fear, moral shame and moral fear. Before religions come into existence, shame and fear govern the whole mankind. Maintain human dignity. Because when there are certain immoral, harmful, wicked things, then, you see, as human being, it is shameful for us to do this. We disgrace, we abuse human dignity. Then maintain, uphold the human dignity, the shame. Moral fear. Certain cruel, wicked deeds which create excitement by considering this is cruel, this is wicked, this is dangerous. I must keep away from this. Then it is called moral fear. I am scared to do this, this dirty or this wicked thing. That is moral fear. These two things also become wealth. When people come to know that these people maintain these two principles, they respect, they trust, they honor them. then these two principles become their wealth. Sutadhanant, gaining knowledge either by listening or reading or thinking. Knowledge is important for us to get the clear picture of our life, this world, this universe, and natural occurrences. Otherwise, we create our own imagination. Before science and technology, modern subjects were introduced, people had so much superstitious ideas, imaginations about the life and the world. I can remember when I was a small boy, every time when rainbow appeared in the sky, what our parents told us, they told, do you know what is that? That is the vessels the God dropped here to take water. So we believe that is because they experience the rain come after this rainbow. For thousands of years they had this belief. So all our imaginations about this world, that worldly phenomena, exactly like this. But scientific knowledge opens our mind, our eyes, to see things, to understand things. But earlier, the Buddha tried to open our mind, but our minds are so stiff, very, very difficult to open. Now you are here. Instead of come and listening to this talk, you can go out and enjoy your life. There are so many enjoyable things, pleasurable things, fascinating, exciting, entertainment. But you have sacrificed all those things. And so why not we go there and learn something? That is important. That means you realized or you admitted that you do not know. If you think you know, you never come here. I think you can remember a great man, Socrates, what he has said. You're supposed to be the best, very highly intellectual philosopher, great thinker at that time in Greece. So when people ask, actually people believe that you know everything. Can you tell us something that you know? He said, I know only one thing, that I do not know. That is the highest achievement. Because you never think that you do not know. You think you know. That means you are not intelligent. One who thinks that he does not know, then take the trouble to learn. Now let us come to the Buddha. The Buddha has mentioned this earlier. He said, Yo balo manyati balyam pandito chapite. If a fool thinks that he knows, he is a real fool. If a fool thinks that he does not know, he is a wise man. Because he had the opportunity to learn. The fool who thinks that he knows, he never takes the trouble to learn anything. Forever he remains as a fool. So we are here to learn something because we know many things we do not know. So knowledge become wealth. Panya naranam ratana. Alavaka. When asked another question, what is the highest gem in this world? The Buddha said, Panya naranam ratana. Panya. Wisdom is the highest valuable gem in this world. All your diamonds and gold and all these things become useless when you compare with your wisdom. Highest gem for the mankind. So knowledge is important to overcome our problems and troubles and worries and disturbances, to avoid certain disturbances, unhappiness, and to get rid of certain worries and disturbances by using that wisdom. Money cannot buy these many things. Money can become a curse. Money can become nuisance for certain things. For certain things, yes. But wisdom can bring many things that money cannot buy. Then this will become the highest wealth. Saddhadhanam, Siladhanam, Hiri, Ottapyangdhanam, Sutadhanam. Chagocha, Chaga, generosity. Contribute something within your capacity for the benefit of others. Don't be stingy, don't be selfish, don't be jealous. Give something that you can. Otherwise, you cannot reduce your craving, selfishness. Whatever you give, remain as yours. Whatever you kept here without giving to others, you cannot claim as yours. When you depart from this world, whatever you have given to others, you can claim as your property. Whatever you left here at home, at that time you cannot claim. See the difference now. That will become property, wealth, your generosity. Last one is Panya, that is supreme wisdom, not ordinary knowledge. Knowledge is not wisdom. Knowledge is the memory. The accumulations of information, either reading or listening, that is called knowledge. Now when you study history, geography, and so many similar subjects, anthropology, we maintain only knowledge, remember these things. But wisdom is the mind that we can use when we are at crossroads. At that time, we do not know what to do, where to go, what to say, what to do. Then wisdom is important there. This wisdom we won't gain very easily by learning, by gaining academic knowledge. We never gain this wisdom. Because mind is clouded. Mind is deluded. Mind is misled. There are a lot of imaginations and misconceptions in our mind. There is no wisdom. If you want to gain wisdom, we have to remove the dark clouds from the mind. Knowledge cannot do that. Knowledge can increase more and more dark cloud. There are very learned people in this world. Their knowledge is wonderful. But they are jealousy, they are egoism, they are stinginess, they are pride. You can see very easy. Then where is wisdom? We never gain wisdom if we keep those wicked things in our mind. We have to reduce and reduce and reduce. Then the mind becomes clear. When these dark clouds were removed through understanding, not by force, through understanding, reduce and reduce and reduce. Mind is responsible. So when these dark clouds are no more in that mind, then there will be brightness. When the brightness is there in the mind, you can see things very clearly. Now if you enter into this hall, if it is completely dark without electricity, you cannot understand what are the things here. You have to touch here and there and guess, but not sure, because you are in the dark. When the brightness appears, the light is there, then you can see things very clearly. What are the things here? That is called wisdom. Now the supreme wisdom that the Buddha gained is called enlightenment. Enlightenment means this brightness. But our enlightenment and the Buddha's enlightenment, when you compare, you can see the vast difference. By using our wisdom and enlightenment, we recognize many things, just like the things that we look at night time through the light come from the stars. No moon, only stars. But there is brightness. Certain things we can find out. The light that come from the stars. When another person, very highly intellectual, develops this wisdom, they can see the things just like at night time when there is a moon. But the moonlight also not 100% sure. So the Buddha's enlightenment, the brightness that he had in his mind, is just like sun's light. Moon and the stars also get the brightness from the sun. That is called supreme enlightenment. So these 10 kinds of wealth we had to develop. Saddha, confident. Sila, discipline. Saddhadana, siladana. Hiri ottapya, shame and fear. Sutta, learning, listening or reading to understand things properly. Then panya, wisdom. Then we are very wealthy. No shortcoming. No weaknesses. Full confidence. This is the way how the Buddha introduced faith how to cultivate this faith. But not simply creating imagination. I have faith in God. I have faith in the Buddha. But when you analyze this faith, why do they want to develop this faith? Not through understanding. They say, we have faith in God, but they do not know anything about God. And those who do not know anything about the great virtues, the qualities and the characteristics of the Buddha, say, we have faith in the Buddha, but do not know anything about it. Buddhism never encouraged this kind of faith through understanding. So we had to do three things. Pariyatti, Patipatti, Pativeda. Three things. As Buddhist, first, we had to study. We must understand who the Buddha is. We must try to understand what the Dhamma is. Otherwise, we cannot start our religious way of life. We make a lot of mistakes. By knowing the Buddha and the Dhamma, then we practice. That knowledge itself, knowing, oh, I know the Buddha, I know the Dhamma, I have read whole Tripitaka, I know the life of the Buddha. That knowledge cannot do any service, any purpose. That knowledge becomes useless. If you do not practice, it is like this. When you are sick, you go to a doctor, or say, Chinese sensei. He gave a prescription, very long one, listen. You come and say, oh, I know that sensei is a very good man, very clever man. He can cure sicknesses. You know the prescription that he has given, wonderful medicine. But you never buy the medicine, you never take the medicine, just keep this. You have wonderful knowledge about the sensei, wonderful knowledge about the prescription. Your Dhamma knowledge is exactly like that if you do not practice. What are the things that you have to practice? In simple language, the Buddha says, you can understand that these things are wrong. Then try to keep away, or not to do. You can understand certain things are very important, very useful. Then try to do. But not enough. You can keep away from bad things. You can do good things, but still you are not good. Why? Your mind is not pure. Your mind is unreliable, changeable. Circumstances can change the mind. Temptation can change the mind. Irritation can change the mind. Uncertainty is there. Therefore, try to purify your own mind. Sacitta pariyo dapana. Why did the Buddha say it like this? Another person cannot purify your mind. Remember this. The Buddha cannot purify your mind. God cannot purify your mind. Your teacher, your parents cannot purify your mind. You are the only one who can do that. Why? Assume. You are very cruel or very cunning. But you know this is wrong. But you have no courage to reduce this. So what you do? Every day you go and pray to a god. I am very cruel, I am very cunning, please take away this cruelty, this cunningness. Every day, if not the Buddha, if not Bodhisattvas, pray and pray and pray, asking to take away this cruelty from your mind. Do you think that they can take away your cruelty from your mind? Impossible. Unless you make up your own mind, you have to think, I must reduce my cruelty, my cunningness, I must be honest, then one day you will succeed. Your effort, your understanding. So, practice. When we come to practice, yes, there are a lot of difficulties. Because we are living in a wicked world. The whole world is corrupted. World is not corrupted. Human mind is corrupted. This corrupted human mind completely pollutes the whole world. Mental vibration, hatred, anger, jealousy, grudge, enmity, ill will, selfishness, all these evil forces completely pollute the whole atmosphere. There will be a day that living being won't be able to survive on this earth anymore. Who is responsible for this? Animals, a spirit, ghost, devils, God? No. Human beings. If there is anybody who destroys this world, that is not God, it's a human being. Already started. That sharp human mind discover more and more things for destructive purpose. What have they discovered to protect the world? Every day they are going on destroying life and world, human mind. See how dangerous is this human mind. How powerful this human mind at the same time. If we cultivate and divert this human mental energy through proper channel, we can create paradise, heaven on this earth. Mano Pubbangama Dhamma. First utterance of the Buddha in the Dhammapada. Human mind is responsible for all good and bad things that exist in this world. 100% correct. Others are not responsible. Others are innocent. We are scared of devils and ghosts and hantus and this and that because of our ignorance. Because they are stupid, we are intelligent. But I don't know why these intelligent people are scared of those stupid fellows. But this mind can be cultivated. Environment, atmosphere, completely pollute. Start from the small children. When they associate, mix up with bad heads, bad here and there, learn all the dirty, wicked, cruel, harmful things. automatically they learn. No need to give tuition. Good things you have to send them to school, give private tuition, still they cannot learn. And this is the nature of the human mind. So our subject is faith and belief in Buddhism. Just now I mentioned, the Buddha did not encourage us to develop faith and belief at once. Study, practice, then you experience whether it is good or bad, the result. I remember one day, a Christian priest came to our temple with a youth group to discuss, very friendly, to have a friendly dialogue about religion. So after discussing, the Christian priest asked, "Can you tell me actually what Buddhists believe?" Then I told him, "Tell you very frankly, Buddhists don't believe anything." He got a shock in his life. Then he has seen my book in the cupboard that I have written, "What Buddhists Believe." Then why did you write that book? That is why I wrote this book. You better read and see whether there is anything for them to believe. Nothing. Then what did you do? That is very interesting subject. Then I explain. First, they study. After study, they think. After thinking, they practice. After practicing, they experience the result. There is nothing to believe. That is Buddhism.